let me now proceed with introducing myself. I am Dean Attorney Joe-Santos Balagtas Bisquera. I have a bachelor's degree in business administration and a certified public accountant, summa cum laude, from the University of the East. I went into the University of the Philippines to finish my Master of Business Administration, MBA, graduating as magna cum laude and the valedictorian, the only UE graduate that topped the UP MBA program. I went back later to the University of the East to finally finish my Bachelor of Laws, cum laude, and class valedictorian. While I was studying for my graduate school, I started my career in the organization of the Controller's Department of ESO that became Petron. I started moving to a number of companies, moving up to senior levels until I reached the position of Executive Vice President, and in other companies, Vice President for Finance, Controller, and Chief Finance Officer. I work with multinational organizations that include Fuji Xerox, Motorola Philippines, in the electronics and semiconductor industry. I already mentioned ESO, and I stayed over when it became Petron in the petroleum industry. At one time, I was also the Director for Finance Administration of Smith Klein and French, SKNF, a pharmaceutical company that today is called GlaxoSmithKline. I was the controller of the construction division, EcoAsia, of the Manila Electric Company. At one time, I was controller and director for financial management of Delgado Brothers Incorporated. I also had a stint with the agricultural chemical sector when I joined the FMC affiliate here in the Philippines pushing Furadan, a leading granular pesticide. And I had a stint with the BOI Pioneer Organization manufacturing intermodal marine cargo containers, Permaline Container Corporation. During my career, both in the business and field of education, actually business, I was nominated 2 times to become Associate Justice of the Supreme Court in 2012 and 2016. I am today a professorial lecturer in mercantile law and criminal law of the Philippine Judicial Academy, the training arm of the Supreme Court of the Philippines for judges throughout the Philippines. Today, I am the Vice President for Legal Services and the Dean of the College of Law, a bar reviewer and a law professor of the University of Manila. Between the year 2009 to 2011, I had a stint as Vice President for Legal Affairs and the Dean of the College of Law of the University of Perpetual Health, both in Las Piñas and in Binyan. I had about 35 years experience as an MBA professor in financial management at the De La Salle University and earlier at the University of the Philippines and UE. Today and in the past, I've been a bar reviewer and law professor, the University of the East, the University of Santo Tomas, De La Salle University, the University of Perpetual Health, San Sebastian College and Far Eastern University. This particular slides or YouTube presentations will start with letters of credit, my first discussion in the field of mercantile law, specifically in the field of banking, which will cover four major topics: the Philippine banking system, the special banking laws, the negotiable instruments law, and international banking, which includes letters of credit and trust receipt. In the special banking laws, I will be discussing extensively the secrecy of bank deposits. One of the exceptions is the anti-money laundering law. I would also be discussing the Uniform Currency Act, the interest rates and the anti-usury law, chattel mortgage, and real estate mortgage. I will have a separate a series of slides on negotiable instruments. And this is my way of trying to help our bar-reviewees, even our own bar-reviewers, our law students, our law professors, the professors and students in business, and those of you in this particular series, specifically letter of credit, those of you who are involved in logistics and importations and would like to understand the bigger picture. So you are welcome to log in to this YouTube presentation so that you will get an integral view of what letter of credit is. The main event of this particular sharing is a schematic diagram, a process flow of the entire mechanism, starting from an importer in the Philippines wanting to buy materials or finished goods or equipment or supplies from abroad. And there is a willing supplier abroad who is to sell to the Philippine importer. The letter of credit comes in order to address their mutual concern that if the buyer in the Philippines would immediately pay, he is not very sure that he will get the goods to be shipped to him. On the other hand, the foreign supplier hesitates also to ship the goods before he gets paid because he's not sure that he will get paid once his commodity leaves his possession. And this is the role of the letter of credit through the sponsorship and active participation of a local credible bank in the local scenario and a corresponding bank in the foreign country. So to start the ball rolling, allow me now therefore to flick the first slide to discuss what is a letter of credit. A letter of credit, my dear friends, is nothing but an issuing bank's undertaking or promise to pay the beneficiary provided all the terms and conditions in said undertaking are strictly complied with. Another concept of letter of credit is that an LC is an issuing bank's promise to a seller exporter to unconditionally pay in behalf of a local buyer or importer for specific goods, provided the exporter follows strictly the terms and conditions of the LLC. The third concept of a letter of credit is an LC is a payment mechanism in the international trade of a creditworthy bank who assumes the buyer's counterparty risk to pay the exporter seller of the goods. To be candid about it, my dear friends, a letter of credit is simply a promissory note with special features dictated by the international bankers who have arrived at a consensus under the International Chamber of Commerce, where they have come up with a uniform set of rules to govern themselves. And this is what is called the uniform custom and practice of documentary credit that binds by way of an industry practice all the respectable banks all over the world. And so having said that, a letter of credit is also known in the international market as one, it is a documentary credit. Meaning, it is a loan, it is a promissory note that is in a document fully designed by the bankers. Number two, an LC is also a banker's commercial credit. The one that is committing to pay on the promissory note is a banker. And the third concept or the third way of looking into an LC is called an LU, a letter of undertaking. Proceeding now to the matter of a bank issuing a promise. When the foreign supplier exporter doesn't have any confidence at all, you know, part of the prudence in business dealing that he will be paid by his customer here in the Philippines. The same question comes up. Is there a guarantee that the bank locally who issues the promissory note called letter of credit will not also cancel the letter of credit? And on the basis of this particular criterion, there are two types of letters of credit. Number one is an irrevocable LC, and the second one is a revocable LC. Now, let us take a look at how they differ by way of the capacity of the issuing bank to change or cancel these particular types of irrevocable versus revocable letter of credit. An irrevocable letter of credit is an LC where the issuing bank's promise cannot be changed nor withdrawn without the seller beneficiaries and the buyer applicant's consent. So the issuing bank's promise cannot be changed, it cannot be withdrawn, it cannot be canceled once the LC is issued by the opening or issuing bank. On the other hand, if the LC is revocable, then it is an LC where the issuing bank reserves the right to cancel the LC before actual shipment is made, even without the consent of the party. Let me emphasize at this point that a letter of credit, by reason of international banking practice, is only revocable before the foreign supplier, the beneficiary of the LC, loads the ordered goods in a ship or an airplane. So from the time that the issuing bank issues a revocable LC, and the LC reaches the foreign supplier through his correspondent bank at that particular point, the issuing bank can invoke the revocability of the LC if it were a revocable LC to either change or cancel said LC with or without the approval of the foreign supplier beneficiary. However, if after receiving the revocable LC, the foreign supplier now prepares the goods for shipment and actually loaded that particular commodity into a ship or an airplane, at that particular point when the commodity has already left the hands of the foreign supplier, even a revocable LC can no longer be canceled or changed. This is fair because if the bank that issued the promise or promissory note can cancel the goods when the goods are no longer in the control and possession of its original owner supplier, that would be tantamount to fraud. Panluloko na yung ganung sitwasyon. And so the moment the goods are loaded into a ship bound for the destination, or it was already loaded into an airplane, again bound for the destination, even a revocable LC can no longer be revoked. Now, the question is, what is the reckoning point on whether or not the goods so ordered have already been loaded into a ship or an airplane? There is a sacred document that governs this particular happening, and that is called the Bill of Lading. The Bill of Lading is the evidence that the goods have already been given to the ship, and the ship captain issued a receipt, a contract, a commitment to deliver that particular commodity. And physically receiving the goods, he now turns over the bill of lading to the shipping company, to the foreign supplier. So when the foreign supplier is already holding on to a C bill of lading, that is already the evidence that the revocable LC can no longer be canceled or modified. Of course, the same is true if he went into the airport and loaded it in a plane. Because instead of receiving a C bill of lading, he will be getting from the airline an airway bill of lading. And so take note, the document of title that determines who has actually ownership of the goods loaded and that he has already complied with the LC requirement of loading the goods ordered is the bill of lading issued by the captain of the ship and called the C bill of lading, or issued by the airline called the airway bill of lading. That is the reckoning point where the foreign supplier can establish that even his revocable LC can no longer be changed or canceled because he has already complied with his commitment to load the goods for shipment to his supplier in the Philippines. There is a unique type of LC called the confirmed LC. So whether an LC is irrevocable or revocable, it can partake of the personality of what is called a confirmed LC. And a confirmed LC is nothing where the correspondent bank guarantees the beneficiary that the issuing bank is a good bank and will pay its obligation according to its LC terms and conditions. Later on, we will learn that when a correspondent bank says, oh, that bank that issued the LC is a good bank and it will pay, the confirmation that the correspondent bank is using will have a collatilla which says that if the issuing bank does not pay, then I am your surety. I will be primarily liable to pay you. That particular correspondent bank is now called a confirming bank, and the LC that is coursed through him is called a confirm LC. With this discussion, therefore, my dear friends, we can now somehow identify two groups of parties in the letters of credit. In the context of the businessman merchant and in the context of the bank. From the point of view of the businessman, there is the businessman in the local scenario who is buying, and we call him the importer. There is, on the other hand, a foreign supplier who's selling, and we call him the exporter. The importer here buys, the exporter abroad sells. And so you have a buy and sell transaction. And the introduction of importer-exporter is to connote that they are separated by their political boundaries. They come from different countries. On the other hand, because these two types of businessmen have concerns on the settlement of their buy-sell transaction, the banks come in as intermediaries. And the bank on the side of the buying importer is called the opening issuing bank because he is the one that will issue the promissory note called the letter of credit in favor of the foreign supplier. On the other side, the selling exporter will have his own ninong. He will also have to fall back on a reliable bank on his side. And that particular bank is called the correspondent bank. And so the banks now, the opening bank in the importing country, and the correspondent bank in the exporting country are the ones talking at the level of international banking. And it is in the mutual trust and confidence of the bankers that the banks corresponding to each other respect each other's rights and privileges, including the protection of their respective clients. Now, some of you may ask, what would prevent an issuing bank from not following the guidelines? Like, for example, what we said that when the goods are already loaded into the ship, then even when the LC is revocable, the bank that issued the LC would still cancel the LC and will refuse to pay. What will happen? Considering that the foreign supplier and his bank are in a separate country, and even if under Philippine law, they can go to the Philippines to file a case of breach of contract of carriage using the letter of credit and probably even the confirmed purchase order as a document for civil action. You know, from a business point of view, businessmen will not waste their time in filing so many cases because that will eat up their time that otherwise they can devote to engaging in their traditional business, not to mention that the cost of litigation, the legal fees would be too expensive and they have to travel, you know, or send their lawyers or engage Philippine lawyers that they will have to pay for. However, would a local bank have a tendency to renege or destroy his promise or commitment? The answer is technically he can, but he will now be facing the entire international banking chain. If, for example, a local bank, say Metro Bank, would issue a letter of credit and would now be giving that in favor of a supplier in the United States. But for example, Metrobank has developed a reputation that it always reneges, it always runs away from its commitment on the letters it issued. What will happen is that the foreign supplier goes now to his bank and consults the bank, and the bank says, you know, that particular bank, Metrobank in the Philippines, we do not deal with them already. Why? Because in so many of our transactions, they do not have a word of honor. And among bankers, the word of honor, the trust and confidence, is your major capital in order to transact internationally. And so if a local bank tries to destroy its reputation by being dishonest and not by living up to its commitment, it will not only be one bank. You know, all the banks now will be talking against this particular local bank and would somehow whisper that they refrain or in effect blacklist this particular bank in terms of dealing not only with the direct bank, but all the other friendly banks, not only in that country, but all the other countries that have international dealings. Just a side comment, you will remember this particular local bank that was involved in the money laundering of the Bangladesh funds. I am not personally in touch with the development there, but you know the local bank would have a lot of problems in dealing with their international correspondent bank because of that incident. And can you imagine the business it would lose because it will not have that kind of relationship, amiable correspondence relationship with the rest of the world. That is the danger in admitting one's commitment when you are a bank who is issuing a letter of credit. No bank will ever accept your letter of credit and recommend to their clients that they deal with that bank. We are now about to go to the process flow of a letter of credit. And there are two process flows that I will share with you. The first one is in the form of a script where we start the procedure from the importer buyer in the Philippines and would end up with him through his bank paying the foreign supplier. So to start with, the first step that an importer, and obviously his seller, the exporter, would do is to start negotiating with each other. Obviously, you have the internet, you can shop around, and of course, to trade practice, you would know if you are a pharmaceutical company, you would know almost all the leading suppliers of raw materials and active ingredients for the pharmaceutical products that you produce and sell in the Philippines. So you would be in touch with these particular suppliers. And so the importer and the exporter abroad will negotiate and finalize by way of the importer issuing a purchase order which the foreign supplier will accept and confirm. Let us say you have a local company here that sees the big potential of manufacturing with a license from the original company that will formulate it, the medicine for COVID-19. And so this importer now negotiates with a foreign supplier, not only for the supply of the raw materials, but also for the license to be the exclusive manufacturer and seller of remdesivir, the first known medicine that can cure COVID-19 in the Philippines. And so when the importer in the local market and the supplier abroad should agree with a confirmed purchase order. The importer locally will now have to go to his bank, because obviously the foreign supplier will not ship the raw materials here unless he gets paid, or unless he has a very strong assurance that he will be paid. And they have agreed that the mechanism is to follow an irrevocable LC. And so the importer here now goes to his local bank to apply for a letter of credit in favor of the named foreign supplier. The local bank obviously would try to assess the financial viability of this importer, its business, you know, its banking relationship with the bank to whom this importer went to. And finally, the bank says, yeah, I will help you. I will issue my promissory note. I will issue my letter of credit so that your supplier abroad can ship the goods arising from the trust and confidence he can give to me. What do I need to do? The importer would ask. Well, first of all, how much are you buying? Says, well, I need to buy $500,000 worth of raw materials for remdesivir. The bank asks, what is remdesivir? Remdesivir is the first medicine that was discovered and formulated that can address, that can cure COVID-19. And it is this particular supplier, Gilead Sciences, based in California, USA, that is manufacturing that and that is giving us a license to manufacture it locally for them and authorizing us to buy from them the required raw materials. So what do I need to do? The importer again asks. Well, if you're buying $500,000 worth of remdesivir raw material, we would ask you to deposit with us the $500,000 so that if and when your supplier would ship the goods to us, then we would be capable of paying them out of the promise we will issue to you in your favor. And the importer starts thinking and says, but I do not have $500,000. As a matter of fact, I will get money if I get that $500,000, manufacture and sell it. And out of the sales I generate, for example, who knows, $1.2 million. That is the only time I can pay you the $500,000. But if you bring in the goods, the bank would say, well, you have now the goods here, what will I use to pay those particular suppliers? And what if you do not pay me? So I need you to set up that $500,000 as your deposit. We will call it your marginal deposit. And we will keep it here in our vaults on standby so that when we finally get the goods here in the Philippines, then we will ask you whether it is now okay to remit the $500,000 value of the LC you are requesting from us to issue. So that is the first mechanism, that the importer here deposits the money that he would pay his foreign supplier. The bank here does not remit unless the bank is comfortable that the shipment was already made and received by his client here in the Philippines. And so the situation is very safe. Instead of the local customer here, the importer, giving the $500,000 to the supplier abroad, and after receiving that, the supplier does not ship the goods, through the intervention of the bank says, I am the one who will pay you. And so you believe in me because I have no reason to cheat you out of my letter of credit because of the international banking pressure on us to live up with our commitments. But the local bank would say, if I'm giving that promise, where will I get the money? So if you are ready to buy and you're ready to pay him, but you're afraid to pay him, then you deposit with the money so that when we already get the goods, I will be the one to pay. So that is the role of the bank in terms of delaying the payment as a condition for the shipment to arrive. And the depositing, the act of depositing, the amount of the LC with the opening bank by the local importer is what is called the setting up of the marginal deposit. So usually, the marginal deposit is 100% and the foreign supplier is somehow assured that his 500,000 now, before he ships the goods, is now in the possession of the bank for issuing the irrevocable LC. Now, let us go to the more practical side. The truth of the matter is, the businessman here doesn't really have all the money in the world because that is his main business unless he gets the raw materials and produces it and sells it. That is the only time he will get the cash. He will get the cash to be able to recover the raw material cost, the cost of his labor and the manufacturing overhead plus his profit. And so when he is able to get the raw materials, manufacture it and sell it, that is the only time he will have the 500,000 US dollars to make it as a deposit. So there is a stalemate. And so the bank says, well, can I have now your 500,000? And the local importer, in all humility, says, I will be very candid with you. And since I'm depositing with you, you know, I don't have 500,000 US dollars. If you can bring down the marginal deposit to say 10% of 500,000, I deposit with you 50,000 US dollars. And you give me, when the bill of lading arrives, I will pay you the balance of 450. Then we will work it out. 10% of your LC amount is not acceptable. I will give you a deal. 75%. So out of the 500,000, you pay me 3/4 of that one. 1/4 of 500 is about 125. So you pay me 475 or 425. And so again, the importer says, I really don't have the money. Can you bring it down to 10%? And the banker says, okay, let's bring it down to 50%. So you pay me 250,000 as marginal deposit. Again, the local businessman says, I do not have 250,000 US dollars, my dear banker friend. And so, go for broke. The bank knows that this is a reputable supplier. And the transaction, once he gets the raw material, he can really make money, the tune of 1.2 million US dollars. The banker says, okay, let's go for broke. I will require you to set up 25% of 500,000. That's about 1/4. And the balance of 75% you pay when the bill of lading arrives to evidence the goods have arrived. And finally, the local supplier says, please have pity on me. I can only assemble 15%. So 10% of 500,000 is 50,000. 1/2 of 50,000 is 25. I can immediately deposit with you 75,000 based on our script. But it will take me a little while. It will take me 3 months. And so we will delay the shipment and I will also delay my operations by 3 months. So the banker says, how much money do you really have? You need to pay me a 25% marginal deposit. And you don't have the 75,000. How much do you have? Well, to be candid about it, I have only 10%. What? You only have 50,000 US dollars. Let's get into a deal. Since you need to pay me the 25%, let me bring it down, go for broke, to 15%. That means you pay me now, you know, something like 10% of 50,000 is 50, plus another 50. So you pay me 75,000 US dollars. That means that you're setting up a deposit of 15%. That's the lowest I can go. And no bank in the Philippines will allow you to set up a marginal deposit lower than 15%. And they come into a deadlock. And the banker is very smart. He says, let's have coffee, let's have some break. And after that, he whispers to the local businessman, you have 50,000, you need 25,000 more to complete the 15%. Secret. I can arrange for you to borrow something like 25,000 US dollars to complete the 75,000 or 15%. I will arrange with my bank that they lend you the 15%, the 25%, and you put up the 50,000, the 25,000 plus 50,000, 75,000 completes the minimum allowed by the central bank for marginal deposit. Agreed? Thank you very much, sir, for understanding my sad situation. But the 25,000 US dollar, you'll have to pay interest on that one. Do you agree? Well, I would have good income out of that 500,000 shipment. I will pay for the 25,000 borrowing to set up my margin deposit. Okay, done deal, sign. So they sign. The bank gets the 50,000 US dollars, that's 10%. And he gives the money of 25,000 to this particular customer, bank client, 25. He says, okay, that's your borrowing to pay me my marginal deposit. And you sign a promissory note that it will bear interest, say of 10%. And so, here's the money, I give it to you, but now you give it back to me because you need to complete the 50,000 plus 25, 75 to complete the 15% marginal deposit. You see how smart the bankers are. The banker will essentially try to find a way, if your relationship with him is good, that you meet the marginal deposit, the minimum marginal deposit, say, of 25%, where he lends you money for the balance that you cannot produce. Of course, he makes money out of that by charging you interest. Now, here's the funny part about it. He goes to his cashier and says, give me 25,000 US dollars. Customer, you sign the promissory note for 25,000. I'll give you your 25,000 US dollar. You merge it now with your 50,000, then you give me now 50,000 plus 25. So you notice how smart the banker is. His 25,000 was only delivered 1 second to the customer and he takes it back. He lends that particular 25,000 as a loan and gets it back as a marginal deposit. That particular loan, the banker earns interest. The marginal deposit, he does not pay any interest at all based on Banco Central guidelines. So overall, he's saving his money and eating it too by lending, and yet the money did not leave him. And so when that marginal deposit of 25,000 is with him, he can again go around and lend out, say, 80% of that with other borrowers. That's how the bankers operate. Talagang maganda. Laway. You know. Now, So after everything has been settled down, sabi ng importer, okay na ho sir. I-issue nyo na yung letter of credit. Teka, sabi ng banko, this is not for free. You're supposed to pay LC opening charges. Ano po yun? For us to open and send the LC using our corporate image, you pay us an LC opening charge. And that is 0.5%. And so with that, the transaction is completed. Obviously, the opening bank now, possessing all the application and ready to issue his irrevocable LC, holding on at least to 25% marginal deposit, starts shopping around for a correspondent bank in the country where the foreign supplier is. Usually that is already done during the preliminary negotiations. The foreign supplier would already nominate a leading bank also in his country. And because all of them are international bankers, the Philippine banker, chances are, would also know and would have tremendous exchange experiences, correspondence experiences with the foreign bank. And so finally, you know, initial communication with the two banks. And so the opening bank now issues the most important document, an irrevocable LC in favor of the foreign supplier, but course through the correspondent bank in the country of the foreign supplier. The correspondent bank, the advising correspondent bank in the foreign country, therefore receives the letter of credit and excitedly goes to the foreign supplier to tell him, here is now your LC, an irrevocable LC, and I am your advising bank as what you said, as what you want. Here, what happens now is, therefore, the foreign supplier becomes excited. He will now have a sale. And he now assembles his own raw materials, manufactures the product that he will be selling. And as soon as the goods are ready, based on the agreed time of departure, he loads the cargo ordered into a ship, an ocean-going ship or vessel. And when he goes to the shipping lines, to the shipping company, he delivers the goods, and the shipping company now gives him a receipt of the goods. And the receipt of the goods will now be evidenced by the most important document, which is the Bill of Lading. The Bill of Lading plays three specific functions. So when the foreign supplier now goes to the shipping company and delivers physically the commodity, the shipping company acknowledges receiving the goods through a bill of lading. So the bill of lading, in effect, is the receipt of physically receiving the goods issued by the receiving shipping company. Second, because these goods in custody of the shipping company is not for them, but bound for the buyer in the Philippines, that particular bill of lading is also called a document of title. So the physical goods are in the possession of the shipping company, but the bill of lading issued by the shipping company will evidence ownership. Ownership, that's why it's called a document of title, of the goods so loaded into the ship. And so when this particular bill of lading is given to the foreign supplier, it is not only an acknowledgement or official receiving report by the shipping lines, it is also a confirmation that this particular foreign supplier continues to be owner of the goods while in transit, or goods in transit too. And since the bill of lading, the original bill of lading, is called a negotiable bill of lading, then that particular foreign supplier now can forward the bill of lading to the local importer here, who will now present this particular document to the captain of the ship, ship, so that there will be now, of course, kaliwaan. The captain of the ship says, where is your bill of lading? I have it with me. Let me get that, and you get the goods in exchange. So the third one is that the bill of lading becomes a means for transferring the title from the owner, the original supplier, to the final buyer in the Philippines. But the third function of the bill of lading is to be able to collect one of the documents, the most important document in the letter of credit. And so this particular bill of lading is the evidence that he has complied with the requirement of the opening bank that he will ship the goods. And so he sends the goods to the local importer through the bank, because it is the bank that promised to pay him. And so he sends the bill of lading, you know, to the bank through his correspondent bank. And so now the supplier abroad carries with him this bill of lading, that's now money, presents it to the advising bank, you know, the correspondent bank, who in turn immediately sends the bill of lading to the issuing bank, so that in effect it is complying with the requirement. There are four other documents that normally a letter of credit requires for submission from the foreign exporter beneficiary to the opening bank through the correspondent bank. And in addition to the bill of lading, the foreign supplier now will issue in effect a demand letter in the form of a demand draft or a bill of exchange. So he's now saying, you pay me based on this demand draft. Now, he will also be issuing a commercial invoice and a packing list. He will have official documents, and the most important of which is the certificate of origin of the goods so shipped, and finally, the insurance documents. So these five sets of documents headed by the bill of lading is submitted to the issuing bank through the corresponding advising bank abroad. The next recipient of the documents would of course be the opening bank in the Philippines. And the opening bank checks the authenticity and completeness of the five sets of documents required under the LC. And assuming that is all in good order and condition, his commitment to pay the foreign supplier to the correspondent bank is already on the table. So he needs now, he is holding on to his 15% marginal deposit, and he can now say, oh, I have 15%, but I need 85% to complete this. He now tells his importer, hey, your goods are already here. I have the bill of lading, and the ship must have already arrived. So if you want to get your goods so that you can now start manufacturing, you go to me and get your bill of lading. And the importer says, by all means, I need that raw material so okay, I can immediately proceed with manufacturing. Well, you can do that, the opening bank says, but don't forget, you need to pay the complete balance of your LC, and you have deposited with me 15%, which is $25,000. You need to complete so that your $25,000 will now become $500. So you need to pay me $475. So please come so that we will need the $475 from you. Plus, on the side, you also owe me about how much? $25,000, because you have the marginal deposit you borrowed from me. So you bring in effect here, $475 plus the other $25,000 to complete the balance already of the $500,000. And so the importer, wanting to get the shipment so he can start manufacturing and selling, goes now to the opening bank. He pays the opening bank the entire proceeds, the entire LC, $500,000, minus what he has already set up as a deposit of 15%, which is 75,000. So he now says, here is the balance of 425,000 plus 75,000. Therefore, I have already paid you the entire 500,000. And on the side, the banker says, hey, but 25,000 of what you're paying me as your marginal deposit, you also I will also collect that from you with interest. And so in exchange for paying the 500,000 to the issuing bank, the bank now says, here is your imported commodity by way of this bill of lading, original and negotiable. And so our importer now rushes to the South Harbor, presents the bill of lading to the captain of the delivering ship. The delivering ship examines the bill of lading and therefore exchanges, let me get your bill of lading, here is your remdesivir raw material. And our importer obviously will have to contend with the Bureau of Customs to pay off the Bureau of the customs duties, and also in behalf of the BIR, the value added tax, and all other charges, the wharfage fees, and if there are any warehousing charges while the goods are awaiting withdrawal, that is paid. And finally, the goods are brought to the factory of the importer so he can start his manufacturing. From the time the bill of lading is received from the bank up to the time the goods are delivered to the door of the importer may directly do it. However, this particular function is done by some experts who call themselves the customs brokers. And they know, you know, the ins and outs and so on. So usually the bill of lading is given to the customs broker, an agent, the importer, who handles all the details. And so the goods now, ultimately, are in the hands of the importer. Meanwhile, the opening bank has all the money to pay on his LC. And so with 500,000, he pays that to the advising bank so that the advising bank can ultimately make the payment to the foreign supplier. Everybody happy. The importer abroad got his proceeds of the sale, and the goods of purchase are now in the hands of the importer. Let us now go to a flow chart of what we have discussed. And here, in a series of steps, in a diagram, we will show now how the movement that we have just described happens. If you looked at the chart on the screen, on the lower left-hand corner, is you see buyer-importer, and we will borrow GlaxoSmithKline, a leading pharmaceutical company in the Philippines, to be the buyer-importer in the Philippines. As we go to the right side, in the middle screen, we see now a company called Gilead Sciences. And Gilead Sciences is a pharmaceutical company producing the raw material and finished product for the anti-COVID-19 cure, which is remdesivir. And they must have already concluded the negotiation that in the Philippines, GlaxoSmithKline will be licensed to manufacture and sell remdesivir for the Philippine patients of COVID-19. And in the Philippines, GlaxoSmithKline goes to its favorite bank, Citibank, in order to ask Citibank to open the LC in favor of Gilead Sciences. And so there you go. GlaxoSmithKline goes to Citibank, as we have already discussed, pays the marginal deposit, pays its LC opening charges. And so at this point, Citibank is ready to communicate with JP Morgan, the correspondent bank in the US for Gilead Sciences. Citibank now issues the letter of credit in favor of Gilead Sciences, coursed through the correspondent bank JP Morgan, who forwards the LC to Gilead in order for Gilead to know that it is now holding on to a letter of credit. And this becomes now the go signal for Gilead now to start his manufacturing of the product or raw material so ordered. And so here, we see now that Gilead Industries has the product now available, the remdesivir raw material. It now engages the service of an international going shipping line to load the goods and for the shipping line to receive the goods and accordingly issue the bill of lading to Gilead. Obviously, we have already discussed that the bill of lading is the receipt of the goods, the contract of carriage for the international shipping line to deliver that to Citibank and GlaxoSmithKline, and finally to serve as a collecting document on the LC. And so Gilead now goes to JP Morgan while the vessel starts to sail, carrying the remdesivir. The bill of lading may even reach Manila ahead of the shipping the vessel. In the diagram, we can now see that the vessel carrying the remdesivir raw material has now reached the Manila South Harbor. It is at this point that Citibank advises GlaxoSmithKline that the commodity is ready and the bill of lading to evidence ownership is already in its possession. Therefore, pay the balance of the LC. And as we already said, GlaxoSmithKline has already deposited the marginal deposit of $25,000. It goes now to Citibank to pay the balance of $475 and also to pay the marginal deposit of $25. And so out of paying Citibank, Citibank now issues the bill of lading, returns it over to GlaxoSmithKline so that GlaxoSmithKline is able to present the bill of lading to the captain of the international shipping ship so that he gets now the remdesivir raw material that he orders. So at this point, GlaxoSmithKline has already achieved its objective of buying for its own use the remdesivir raw material. In turn, because Citibank has already the $500,000 and all the documents have been submitted by Gilead, Citibank now remits or pays Gilead by way of JP Morgan, who ultimately gives the money to Gilead. And so that completes the entire transaction. The concern of GlaxoSmithKline that it doesn't want to pay unless it gets the goods. He gets the goods and he pays. On the other hand, Gilead, who is afraid that he may not be paid, ships the goods out of the promise of Citibank and now gets the money. So both of them now meet their respective objectives. This whole transaction is governed by certain basic principles in letters of credit. The first principle in letter of credit is the doctrine of independence. The opening bank, here Citibank, assures the seller beneficiary, which is Gilead Sciences, of prompt payment, independent of any breach of the main contract. The contract is a purchase sale agreement, to preclude the issuing bank from determining whether the main contract is actually accomplished or not. The bank is not concerned with the fulfillment of the main contract. It will only deal with the requirement that he put in the letter of credit. So if there is any breach of contract, in the purchase sale agreement that will not prevent the bank from paying. Now, as a side comment, you say, what if the supplier sent the wrong goods? And so that therefore, the buyer does not get the goods that he wants to purchase. How would the bank now behave? The bank would say, I have nothing to do. I'm not involved with the quality of the goods. And so the bank will now pay regardless of whether or not there is any dispute in the quality of the goods. That is the theory. In the real practice, what happens is that part of the document that the importer will ask the bank, the issuing bank, to indicate is a certificate of inspection by a reputable technician, by a reputable chemist or what have you, at the point of origin, at the time that the goods are loaded in the vessel. And so here, therefore, the theory that the bank has nothing to do with the main contract is true. But in the documentation requirement for the LC, the minimum requirement for quality assurance can be contained as one of the documents that the foreign supplier has to submit. And for as long as, therefore, that particular reputable inspection report is part of the submission, then indirectly the bank has assisted the foreign, the domestic buyer to assure the quality of the goods. But the focus is that here is my LC, here are the required documents, including the inspection report from a reputable inspector, and if you submit that, then I pay you. That's the doctrine of independence. The second doctrine is called the doctrine of strict compliance. The doctrine of strict compliance simply talks about the fact that the seller beneficiary, this is in the case, for example, Gilead Sciences, must tender all documents required by the LC strictly to conform with the LC claims. And that was why I was mentioning a while ago that one of the required documents may be a certificate of inspection. Now, when the correspondent bank, in this case JP Morgan, accepts a faulty tender, meaning, for example, it is a fake or a fraudulent certificate of inspection, or even the bill of lading is doctored, or any other documents, including the insurance documents, are all fake, and the correspondent bank accepts these documents. As a matter of fact, as a negotiating bank, it even pays in advance on the amount of the LC, then that particular correspondent bank, JP Morgan, may not recover from the buying issuing bank any payment made to the beneficiary, because the ultimate determinant of whether or not the documentation requirement in the LC has been complied with is the final decision of the issuing bank. In the Philippines, it so happened this way, that it is a local supplier selling logs, you know, yung logs, lumber, to a foreign buyer in the United States. And obviously, it is the reverse. It is JP Morgan, for example, that issues an irrevocable letter of credit in favor of this Ilocano supplier coursed through Citibank. And one of the LC required documents is a certification from a reputable inspector called Christiansen, who is supposed to be at the port of loading in Cagayan in order to inspect and accordingly issue the certificate of acceptability of the quality of the logs. For some reason, Christiansen refused to issue the certificate. And so knowing that a certificate on quality assurance is required by the LC negotiation, the domestic supplier now secured the inspection certificates of the Bureau of Customs and the Bureau of Forestry that the slag so loaded meet the requirements of acceptability. And so when the local supplier, having shipped the goods now loaded into the vessel, carrying a bill of lading, and presenting the LC documents to Citibank, and Citibank forwarding it to JP Morgan as the issuing bank, JP Morgan looked for the certificate from Christiansen. And the Christiansen certificate was not among the LC documents that were submitted. And therefore, JP Morgan refused to pay on the basis of the doctrine of independence and strict compliance. And the fact that a certification from the Bureau of Customs and the Bureau of Forestry were presented in place of the Christiansen certification, such substitute certification was not allowed in the LC. And so here, the beneficiary of the LC did not get paid, following the concept of doctrine of independence and doctrine of strict compliance. The third principle in letters of credit is the principle of fraud exception principle. That fraud or panloloko is an exception to the independence principle, where there is untruthfulness of a certificate for LC payment to merit an injunction. In effect, if this particular thing happened in the Philippines, in that in the shipment of remdesivir, there is supposed to be a certification by a reputable chemist in the U.S. of the quality of the raw material that was shipped. And it appeared that when the submission, the certification is not the original certification, but a reproduced or scanned copy. And when the original was subsequently submitted, it was established that that particular certification is a forgery. The forgery is fraud. And therefore, if it were Citibank, that is the opening bank, and JP Morgan and Gilead Sciences to their agents in the Philippines would insist on collecting, Citibank is to go to the court to file for a petition for injunction in order to legally prevent it from having to pay that particular LC by reason of fraud. The fraud with clear proof constitutes fraudulent abuse of the LC's independent purpose and not only fraud under the main agreement. Irreparable injury or recovery of damages can be seriously damaged when no injunction is issued. With this discussion, therefore, we have the opportunity to understand what are the responsibilities or liabilities of a correspondent bank. In our example, JP Morgan. When JP Morgan acts only as an advising or notifying bank, it has no obligation or liability to the foreign supplier Gilead concerning the settlement of the LC. But when the bank is a confirming bank, as we already said, then it says that Mr. Gilead, I know Citibank, I know it's a good bank, and I am sure it will pay the obligation. And if it refuses to pay the obligation, I am primarily liable to pay you as the surety. So here the confirming bank now, confirming that the LC will be paid, will now become a principal credit debtor. He will be liable equally with Citibank to pay that particular importer. finally, a correspondent bank can also be a negotiating bank. By being a negotiating bank, that particular correspondent bank may be willing to pay in advance, to advance the funds on the demand drop by discounting demand drop and saying, okay, I pay you $500,000, but I withhold the portion of 5% which becomes my fee. When this is the situation, the negotiating bank has already made an advance payment, but if it presents a document that is defective, again, just like a confirming bank, it will not be paid and will therefore be exposed to the liability of having to pay the proceeds of the letter of credit. Finally, we go to the governing laws that affects letters of credit. It says, the uniform customs and practice for documentary credits or USP is a set of rules on the issuance and use of letters of credit which bankers and commercial parties use in more than 175 countries or 11-15% of international trade. In effect, the uniform customs and practice for documentary credits is accepted as the international rules governing letters of credit which bankers will follow. The International Chamber of Commerce is composed mostly of banks and has developed the techniques and methods for handling letters of credit in international trade finance. And by publishing these particular rules, the USP serves the purpose of the bank, international banking in letters of credit. The ICC rules of practice are designed by bankers and merchants and not by legislators with political and local considerations. The rules demonstrate the needs, customs, and practices of business. And because the rules are incorporated voluntarily into contracts, the rules are flexible while providing a stable base for international review, including judicial scrutiny. Meaning, even if the ICC rules, which is the UCP, is not a political legal document, the fact of the matter is when businessmen enter into contracts involving LCs, they incorporate in the main contract, the contract of buy and sell, the purchase order, and so on, that this particular relationship will be governed by the uniform customs and practice for documentary credits as developed and issued by UCP. And so, it will now have a legal binding effect in terms of disputes. International revision is thus facilitated, permitting the incorporation of the changing practices of the commercial parties. The next topic is essentially already outside of the coverage of letters of credit. But anybody who deals with letters of credit, especially if one is an exporter, would be interested to find out what is an export packing credit line. An export packing credit line is a loan specifically tailored for exporters and sellers to finance the goods procurement before shipment. And so here you will notice, therefore, that a seller-exporter with an irrevocable letter of credit can borrow from the bank. An export packing loan of about 80% of the LC value by putting up the LC as his collateral. So here is a setup where if you have now a local supplier, exporter, and he has a foreign buyer, customer, an importer, and therefore he solicits that this particular exporter, importer buyer, issues to him an irrevocable LC, say $100,000. Under the export packing credit line, this Philippine exporter can now go to his bank, Citibank, and say, can you ask the help of the Department of Trade and Industry and the Banco Central for me to have an export packing credit loan equivalent to 80% of this $100,000? And so he is expecting $80,000. The advance is to purchase raw materials because he may have some other raw materials other than those available from a foreign market that can be also subjected to an import LC. But he also has to pay his people who will run his factory. He will have to pay the utilities like Meralco and water, and all of these expenses. He will have to buy packaging materials. He will have to solicit transport for the goods and services to be exported. So this packing credit is used for financing the working capital and meet the requirements of wages, travel expenses, and utility payments for companies listed as exporters. The lending bank, in this case Citibank, serves as the advising correspondent bank, so he can immediately withhold the 80% proceeds of the LC to pay the packing loan. And so this, in effect, is the coverage of the export packing credit line. We have therefore, my friends, completed our discussion on letters of credit. We have shown to you the various ramifications where a letter of credit is the main vehicle for undertaking the importation of raw materials by a Philippine buyer in relation to an unwilling seller in the foreign market because of the problem of being paid. These letters of credit is not only good for the bar examination. I remember when I took the bar examination, about two questions on this one and a related one trust receipt were given. So out of those 20 questions, about four were given. And I recall it is the first time that letters of credit were asked in the bar examination. And I was lucky because I don't feel that my examiner in mercantile law liked my other answers in the other problems. But it is in the letters of credit, which I pretty well know, where my answers were absolutely correct. Before I took the bar examination, out of my experience as a chief finance officer, I was actually a professorial lecturer in the leading seminars in Makati on letters of credit. And so this, in effect, is the coverage of letters of credit in the bar examination. And at the same time, for you who would like to understand the fundamentals, you can again run through this particular series of slides for you to learn.